It is Kate Baconsale. You're listening to Baconsale.
We picked the good, we picked the bad, and that may make you kind of sad. It's Baconsale. It's Baconsale. There's some themes we gotta pick for shows. You're learning lots. That's how you know it's Baconsale. It's Baconsale. Other podcasts never seem to be living up to your dreams. And suddenly you're finding out the Baconsale's all about you. Hey. There we go, everybody.
Wow. You know, Kent, you took the good and you took the bad.
And I made it bad?
You made it. You took them all and there you had that intro. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome, yeah. Everybody.
I don't know what that was.
What?
I have no idea.
You take the good, you take the bad, you take them all in there. You have the facts of life.
The facts of life.
No.
Really?
Never.
Wow. Poor Tootie. Poor Tootie.
I haven't heard of it.
You know, one day, Zach, when you get older, you're going to be surprised by what kids don't know that you know.
Is that on Fortnite?
Yes. No,
stop that right now.
It's on Fortnite.
Is that a Minecraft game?
Welcome to Baconsale. I'm Joel.
I'm Kent.
And I'm Zach.
We'd like to thank you for listening to our last show, our childhood favorite test of time, where we threw out some very random movies and talked about them at length for an hour.
Yeah. We never thought we'd be talking about those kind of movies on Baconsale, but it seemed to ring true for a lot of people.
I want to thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to talk about Double Switch in a public forum.
Have you been waiting 5.5 years to talk about this movie?
Yes.
I'm very happy
Student Exchange is next.
Watch Elizabeth Shue in anything. So
it's true. It's true. Save it for that show.
Please. Can we?
Absolutely.
I'll watch Shue Show.
I'll watch The Saint again.
Boom, 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 boom.
What I really liked about the show was it gave a lot of the listener an opportunity to kind of reminisce as well. There was a fun teaser that went out where, you know, we were asking, hey, what show did you want from your childhood?
What do you want to find on streaming?
And Joel was like granting wishes left and right.
I had
finding
so
them.
Much fun.
It was amazing.
People were like, I haven't seen this show in years. I'm like, found it. Here you go.
Which is crazy because all it takes is Google.
And some skills.
Well, yeah. And caring.
I have a very special set
and
of
the actual care. Okay, Liam Neeson over here.
Well, I can Google
I
things.
Will find it.
I can Google things.
Well, there were some fun comments, too. We actually had one on Instagram, which is rare. So thank you.
Are you saying people need to comment more on Instagram?
No, I think people like Instagram a lot, but yeah, not a lot of comments.
You can
there.
Comment there, too. It's fine. Is it Bryce R. Other? Bryce Rather? Anyway. Oh, I have one. Ring Raiders. It was a cartoon about time-traveling fighter pilot. We had the VHS movie, which is basically a long commercial for their toy line that you could only order through their 1-800 number.
Yeah, little toy. There were toy rings with like planes on the top that you put on your hand and you could fly along with the TV show.
And it got its own TV show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although I wasn't able to help people on... That's actually true. On Instagram, I wasn't putting out links
because you can't
do links in Instagram, which is stupid.
Like, I don't care
your links
about
in the
you.
Bio for the next 5 minutes. Yeah. Over on Twitter, at Foxes says, the Rankin and Bass Hobbit was well watched by me as a kid. Other movies, I watched The Brave Little Toaster more than once and Land Before Time. So those are ones I watched.
Yeah, I've seen
about those. As obscure as yours, Zach.
Yeah, not very.
Not very.
I am from a different era.
Facts of life. Don't know it.
I don't know it.
Yeah, they didn't have obscure movies when he was a kid.
My parents,
readily
everything
available.
Was mainstream. It's just, I have to thank my parents for being young 20-somethings, and they're like, we're going to watch not those kids' movies. It's great. Terminator 2? Let's do this.
Absolutely. Zach's childhood.
And then over on Facebook, Blake T. Haywood said, well, holy poo, I just watched this family favorite with my two boys the other day, referring to the Buttercream Gang.
I'm so sorry.
Well, I watched it and teared up remembering all the parts of this movie, basking in the memories of my youth. My boys got bored and left after the first couple scenes. I loved this movie and can quote a lot of it.
Yeah. That's Utah for you.
But that's just it. Like, a lot of these movies I'm watching, I'm like, isn't it great? Isn't it great? And my kids are like, meh.
You're like, is that a threat?
No, it's a promise.
So thanks for commenting. We really appreciate it. And it was a fun week, especially because it was pretty random and very nostalgia. Like specific to us. So especially
not,
you guys.
But we're not talking about that today. What are we talking about today, Zach?
We are revisiting something that was brought to us by a listener emeritus in Adrian Gray.
Adrian!
We are revisiting TV themes.
Yes. So
part two.
I want to give us all a pat on the back, if I may, gentlemen. Everyone, pat yourself on the back.
I already do.
For how long... We held off on doing this show again because as soon as we were done in December of 2019, if you go back to this episode 233, the best tunes of television, we got done and we're like, there's so many. And this was so much fun.
Oh, we came
Let's
up
do
with
it again. Let's
multiple
do it again.
Categories. And we only did 10 on that show.
We had a ton.
Yeah.
And we're like, let's do it again. And then we held off these past 8 months. And now we're like, okay, now we can do it.
But here's what I hate about these shows. And I've learned I'm also kind of wrong is that when you use a show on this show about soundtracks, you can't use it anymore. And because I felt like we had used the best possible scores and theme songs in that one episode until I went back and did the research for this one.
There's so many good ones out there.
There are just so many out there.
Well, even then, we have 13 categories.
Yeah, 13.
And so we have 13 categories that we're going to be going through today of popular TV theme songs. And even then, I still have a whole list of ones that I wanted to use and couldn't find a place for.
So you're saying
categories for maybe next time.
In approximately 8 months, we'll be doing part three?
Maybe. Or maybe we'll be doing an animated version where we do only animated.
That would be incredible.
Because that would be a lot of fun, too.
I'd be really in on that.
But let's get started. Zach, which category are we starting with?
Something that we often do on the show. Best to sing along with your friends.
I'll start off because I feel like mine is pretty obvious.
Okay.
And I'm going to let it play to see if it's true. You guys ready for this?
Yeah.
Not at all surprised.
Bus fly by, it's all right, because I'm saved by the bell.
So this, of course, is Saved by the Bell.
I like this category. Fun to sing with friends. Like, you just break out in a round of song.
Well, the thing is, I feel like a lot of people will start singing this song, and then they'll stop until bus flies by. And that's like everyone goes, bus flies by. And then they sing the rest of the song. Now, this is from Saved by the Bell, which you don't know. 4 seasons, 86 episodes. Went from 1989 to 1993. The synopsis. A close-knit group of 6 friends get through their teens together while attending Bayside High School in Palisades, California. Now, we could do an entire episode about Saved by the
Bell. Don't say we could, because we will.
We will one
day. Yeah. Please no.
But we're just focusing on... Oh, Zach, have you not watched Saved by the Bell?
Not all of it. So I'd have to rewatch
the
whole thing.
Gonna.
I just finished it.
Hey.
So I'm totally ready to do it. But I'm going to focus just on the theme song, which was composed by Scott Gale and sang by Michael Damian. Now, the weird thing about the box set is when you watch the box set of Saved by the Bell, and I think maybe even on Amazon Prime where it is now, some of the episodes... The theme song sounds a little different, and it's because after a few seasons, I don't know exactly what happened, but Scott Gale ended up singing. Scott Gale wrote the song, and in fact, he wrote it. They when they came up with the idea for the show, they were like, hey, don't use the name of the show. We don't want anything about school or the title Saved by the Bell.
It's like, so weird how themes do that.
Yeah, they're like, let's limit this bit. And then this guy, Scott Gale, didn't get the note, and so he submitted this one which says Saved by the Bell. It's like the hook of the song.
Good.
And then they went, oh, yeah, that actually is really good. Let's do that one.
Because some of these are really like vague about what the show is. It's like finding my way in life, and it could be for any show or sitcom.
Yeah.
Thankfully, this one directly applies.
And it fits so well. Like, I can actually, as I hear this song, I see the credits in my mind where they do the clips of everybody. I know all the names of
all
the
characters. I love the verse where Zack can freeze time.
When Zack freezes time with the timeout.
Oh, wait.
Sometimes he alters his reality. Then they switched the singer, though. Like, the creator, Scott Gale, ended up singing some of the song, and it just doesn't sound right. So if you ever hear a different version of it, just know that they're, I don't know why, maybe Michael Damian, like, was only up for a certain number of episodes before he was going to get paid more, so they cut him off.
Huh.
Just had the creator do it again. But Scott Gale also did such hits as Friends Forever, Did We Ever Have a Chance, and Go For It. So Zack Attack and Hot Sunday Songs, also written by Scott
such
Gale.
Such hits as in the show and
yes,
nowhere else.
Friends Forever. Anyway, Saved by the Bell is one I feel if it comes on, especially if you're fans of the show, you just belt this out with all your friends and have a good time doing it.
It's a great song.
So, Saved by the Bell.
All right, Zach, what do you got?
All right, mine is more my era a little bit.
Ha! How do you sing this?
Go, go, Power Rangers!
Go, 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 Power Rangers!
Yeah, it's the best.
Go, go, Power Rangers.
Here's the harmony.
Mighty Morphin Power Rangers.
Okay.
Wow. Well, that was
just the worst.
That was not harmony.
I just had to bring in the bass, okay?
Oh, man.
I loved the Power Rangers. It was from... No, this is the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. It's been on forever, as long as I've been alive. But 1993 to 1996 was the Mighty Morphin years. And this song, actually, I was in the Madrigal Choir in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And as your initiation, you got kidnapped and then you had to sing a
what?
Song.
Okay.
Yeah. So we got like, it was like they kidnapped us and took us to Denny's. Like, but I had a little thing around my neck that said, make me sing my song. My song was actually at Power Rangers, but it was like, go, go, baby Mads. It was really nerdy. But I'm pretty connected to the song.
Singing at Denny's.
Joel, we made a mistake.
At the Denny's. Just like that. Like, it's this cool, like, very aggressively 90s.
It's very fun.
In fact, fun to sing along.
When I was in a comedy group, DC Comedy, which is post-divine comedy, long story, doesn't matter. There was a scene where the actors jump on each other's shoulders and start fighting as if they're like, you know, Megasaurus and all that.
Megazord.
And so, but I kind of knew the show. I didn't really watch it that much, but I knew the theme song, but I only knew the one part of it. So they said, and then you just do like the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers theme. And so all I did was just sing over again. Go, go Power Rangers.
That's all you need to do.
You Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. Go, go Power Rangers. It's comedy.
Yeah,
it was comedy, so it worked, but yeah.
Have I mentioned on the show how I used to like make movies with my friends and we did a Power Rangers spoof? And so I was Blue Ranger, so I had blue sweats and a blue sweater. He's my favorite. And then I put Whitey Tidies.
Because he was the nerdy one.
And you like Donatello, too. I think this is a type.
No, I'm a type. Yeah.
You like smart guys.
I put Tidy Whiteys over my sweats and we'd go outside like in my side yard and make these movies and all my neighbors could see. Weird kids making movies in their tidy whities.
I've been there, Kent.
Okay, thank you. Validation, right there.
We once made a movie where I tied steak knives. We were doing a Freddy Krueger movie, and I tied steak knives to a glove.
Yeah, and a garden glove.
I came home. My dad was talking to some friends out front in the front of the house, and I come back. I'm like, "Hi, Dad. I have steak knives in my hand."
I'm worried about my son.
Yeah.
All right.
What do you got, Kent?
The song I chose. I just want to sing this. Maybe the world is blind. Dun, 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 dun. Or just a little unkind. You don't know this one?
Yes, I do. Of course I do. I was letting you sing it. It's Punky Brewster.
Of course it's Punky Brewster. Zack, do you know this one?
Barely.
So once again.
Maybe the world is blind.
It's just so sweet.
How dare you? How dare you question my love for Punky Brewster? How dare you?
I just want to make sure.
I kicked a hole in the wall for this show.
Wait, go on.
I had a tantrum because I couldn't watch it, and I kicked a hole in the wall.
Were you stuck in a fridge? You're like, maybe the world is blind.
I was stuck in a cave with a weird peyote hallucination.
This show was so dang weird. Let me give the synopsis, which Wikipedia gives, and it's the saddest thing you'll hear today. Penelope Punky Brewster is a warm, funny, and bright child. Her father walked out on her family, then her mother abandoned her at a Chicago shopping center when they were shopping for groceries, leaving Punky alone with her dog, Brandon. Afterwards, Punky discovers a vacant apartment in a local building managed by Henry Warnemont, an elderly widowed photographer with a grouchy streak.
Yep.
What a weird show.
But it was so much fun.
It was so great. It's so really lovable. Soleil Moon Frye.
Yeah.
Crush of my childhood.
Yeah.
And even now... that she's aged.
She was also in Saved by the Bell.
She aged very
she
well.
And she is apparently going to be in a revival on Peacock.
No.
With Sherry
Stop
as
it.
Well. So this one ran on NBC.
No Margo? They're not going to let Margo back?
She,
what about Brandon? Is Brandon going to be in it?
I don't know.
The dog?
Brandon's great-great-grandchildren.
Maybe.
But this one ran from 84 to 86 on NBC, then syndication from 87 to 88. This one was written by Gary Portnoy, who also wrote the theme.
For Cheers.
For Cheers.
Yeah.
So this guy's a TV legend.
Seriously. Yeah.
I love this show. Always did. Yes, the only two episodes I remember are the fridge one and then the weird Hawaiian.
Well, the one in the cave.
Yeah, the cave one.
Yeah, that one freaked me out.
But still, this show's great and I love this song so much. Even if I'm having a down day, maybe the world is blind.
It's a good one.
You can't help but be happy when you sing
it. It's a good one.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'd sing along with it, but...
You wouldn't sing along because you didn't know the show.
I know the show. How dare you?
Yeah.
Question my love for Punky.
All right, next up we have Doesn't Fit the Show, and I'll go first on this one. We actually recently talked about this very show on Baconsale.
Although they didn't do the words in defense of MASH.
That's true. But
sorry, I gave you the scoop. Aaron, that's what it is.
This is MASH.
What?
I hear it's a show no one should ever watch.
From 1972 to 1983.
There's a lot of passionate MASH fans out there.
I always thought that this... the theme was so mellow. I never knew it was like a comedy
it
with a laugh
like
track.
It seemed like a drama to me.
Yeah.
Zach, do you know what that title track is called?
Something Suicide is something.
Suicide is Painless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, which in the movie, they play that song a number of times that like, it makes sense because this is a miserable movie. But on the show, I was like, this goofy comedy does have a... And when we say doesn't fit the show, it really is kind of a tonal thing here where it's just like...
Tone deaf, you're right.
Not tone deaf, but just like you watch the theme and you're like, how does that really, it doesn't feel like the show you're about to watch or that you have watched.
Yeah.
So I see that. I totally see that.
Yeah. It's just, I never, in seeing the
you don't
theme,
think you're
going to
hear a laugh track right after
no.
that. Yeah.
I see this goofy comedy and I get the connection, but it just always threw me off. Very yeah. strange choice.
All right, my choice is a show I've never seen, so I kind of cheated, but I don't think this fits. I saw one episode, okay?
Okay.
So all you people out there You've are getting Buffy? Upset.
Shameless.
Yeah, it's Buffy.
I knew it.
It's this song, which I don't think either of you will know.
X-Files.
It's You're been gosh, a long road getting from there to here.
Would you believe?
Is this Star Trek Enterprise?
It's Star Trek Enterprise. Enterprise.
This is don't you doubt me! Star Trek don't you doubt my knowledge of Star Trek Enterprise!
You stop it right now.
I've never seen it. But I did see that one pop up on a number of worst.
And that's why I picked it. Genius. I was going through, like, what doesn't fit? I'm like, wow. People must have been upset by this, and they were. There was an online petition with over 2,000 signatures, which isn't a lot compared to nowadays. But still, one fan said, "We wish to express our unmitigated disgust with the theme song that has been selected for the new Enterprise series. It is not fit to be scraped off the bottom of a Klingon's boot."
Oh,
yeah.
Burn.
And not only were fans upset, and granted, this show ran for 4 years before it was canceled. The showrunners even said,
"Which one's Enterprise, Kent?"
It's the one with Scott Bakula.
Oh,
so
whoa,
it's
what?
Pre-Star Trek, Star Trek.
I thought this was like one of the new ones.
It is. So it came out in 2001.
No, I meant like the new ones like now. Like, is it Discovery?
Discovery.
Is that the word?
It is Discovery. No.
Or Picard or something like that. I thought it was that Picard. Era.
Yeah, no, this was meant to be like kind of a legit one on an actual network with a good cast. But yeah, no one liked this one. It sounds like Bryan Adams doing country rock. So the showrunners wanted U2's Beautiful Day. Said like, we wanted an exploration sort of mood. And then
I can see that
that song cost way too much to use. And so you're like,
obviously,
hey, let's use this.
Couldn't
song.
They do like a knockoff? Like, it's a gorgeous morning. Yeah.
To travel in space. But here's the thing. This is an original song for Enterprise. This was sung by Rod Stewart for the soundtrack to Patch Adams. And then they brought it over to Star Trek Enterprise.
Oh, that's a downer.
Faith of the Heart is what it's called.
This is wow. terrible.
It's wow. a terrible song. And granted, I don't know if the show is all that great. Man, it doesn't fit a Star Trek show because those have like big brass and everything,
yeah.
and like an opening
spacey
monologue,
noises.
Spacey noises for sure.
The yeah. themes, the original theme and the Next Generation theme, are like all timers.
For yeah. It's a ghost.
I can't do it.
Star Trek. No,
progressively weaker.
I legitimately like my choice,
but it just doesn't fit.
It just doesn't fit.
Look at what's happened to me.
Do either of you know this one?
Oh, yeah.
Are you sure? Because it's Punky Brewster.
You better. That was you.
No.
I'm up on top of the world. It should have been somebody else.
Here we go.
Believe it or not, I'm walking on air.
I never thought I could feel so free.
Believe it or not, I'm really not home.
That's Believe George. It or not, George isn't at home.
So this is...
I almost chose this for Sing Along With Your Friends, actually.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a great one.
Yeah.
Like, this actually, legit, okay, this is from the theme from The Greatest American right, Hero, right Believe It or Not. It's by Mike Post and Stephen Geyer, who did, and sung by Joey Scarberry. This is like his only hit, the poor guy.
Yeah.
He hit like the Billboard Hot 100. This was like the number two. Kept off only by Endless Love by Lionel Richie. That was the and Diana Ross. That kept them from hitting number one. It spent 18 weeks in the top 40.
Wow.
This is a great song. And I was actually introduced to it initially because of Chipmunks.
Yes.
Chipmunks Go Hollywood. They sang it.
Yeah.
But The Greatest American Hero ran from 1981 to 1983. Three seasons, 45 episodes. A teacher is asked to be a superhero using a special alien suit with powers he can barely understand or control.
Mm-hmm.
And then you hear this song, and it sounds like this kind of heartfelt
adult
drama.
Contemporary.
Or a love story.
Yeah.
Like, believe it or not, I'm walking on air. I never thought I could feel so free.
Meanwhile, in the opening credits, he's like...
It's because he can't fly.
He's shaking.
So he gets a suit.
Yeah.
He can't quite fly right. And so he's just kind of wiggling around whenever he flies, and it's done for laughs.
Yeah.
And then you hear the song, and you're like, what? That doesn't really fit.
I think it only fits because we tie it to the show nostalgia-wise.
Yeah,
because... It's bigger than the show itself.
Yeah. This song has appeared in Seinfeld, as we mentioned, as George Answer Machine. It's also appeared in Mystery Science Theater, Supernatural, The Goldbergs, Heroes, Family Guy, ER, My Name is Earl, and Gilmore Girls. All of them have featured this
song. You had to
throw
in Gilmore Girls, didn't you?
Of course I did. But Mike Post, the guy who wrote this song, he's done a ton of themes.
Like, Essie.
He did the A-Team, Rockford Files, L.A. Law, Quantum Leap, Magnum P.I., Hill Street Blues. He also is the
Hall of Famer right there.
He composed the dun-dun in
what?
Law and Order. That's him.
That has probably made him more money than any of his other things.
Yeah, probably. So, yeah, believe it or not, I love this song. And I did.
We believe it.
This is one of those songs. Like I said, I make little songs for my kids. This became one of my kids' songs with altered lyrics, by the way.
Naturally. You know,
it's not like I'm singing the theme to Grace right here to my kid.
Just like rocking them to sleep.
Yeah, but it's like, believe, like it's like, who can it be that's singing your song? Believe it or not, it's daddy. Like stuff like that.
Fun.
Oh, I just teared up. That's so cute.
So this song has a special place in my heart. I enjoy it, but it does not fit the theme of a goofy superhero comedy.
It's too chill.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Much too chill. So good.
On this episode, we have a bunch of categories that are very much like that one. Super positive. like this one, most memorable song from a forgettable show. What do you think, Kent?
I'm really curious if you know this one, Joel. Zack, once again, I'm giving you no faith on this one,
but
I'm going to play the song and see if Joel knows this. Here we go.
This is better than my imagination. This is more than a dream come true.
Give it a second. You'll hear it. Here we go. My secret identity.
Oh my gosh. You're bringing up my secret identity?
Yeah. See? You forgot about it, didn't you?
I did. This gosh.
Zack, I was right, right?
No clue.
Yeah. This is a Canadian TV series that ran from 88 to 91 and aired in syndication here in the U.S.
Sliders. What is
Jerry O'Connell. The show is Jerry O'Connell stars as 14-year-old Andrew Clements, who, while looking one day for his friend, Dr. Benjamin Jeffcoat, trips and is hit by a photon beam, causing him to develop superpowers.
Zach's got his overwhelmed eyes on.
I don't know what this is.
He uses these abilities to fight crime, to solve personal problems, and to help others. He hides his powers from his mother, sister, and friends, with the exception of Jeffcoat. Andrew initially called himself Ultraman, but this was later dropped.
Wow.
This is chubby Jerry O'Connell in a Canadian TV series.
Do you know who Jerry O'Connell is?
Yes, I do. Okay. And by the way, Jeffcoat.
He was in Kangaroo Jack.
He was.
That's the same name.
And Scream 2. He was married to Rebecca Romaine Stamos.
Is?
What? Is?
Is.
Rebecca
is.
Romaine Conner.
Don't take
Romaine.
That away from him.
Sorry, I get confused on the timeline of her marriages.
Yeah. And this is one of those shows where the superpowers just kind of come and go and become what they need. It's a My Pet Monster situation.
I forgot the show existed, Kent.
Yeah, everyone should. But at the same time, this theme song has always kind of been in the back of my head for some weird reason. And I still enjoy it.
Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah. What do you got, Joel?
Mine. Okay. So this is the category I probably bounced around the most on answers because there's ones that are memorable for me, but I don't know if other people know them as well. And so I did this. I picked this one because I thought that it might be more memorable for you guys, even if you don't know the show.
Not for me, apparently.
We'll see.
We're just talking down to Zack this entire time.
I'm not talking down to him. I generally want to know if this sounds familiar. Okay.
Peter Gunn.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like everyone knows the theme.
You know why I know it, though? Damn. Why do you know it? I know it because this is theme music that's playing in a game, Spy Hunter. Way more than true. I know the show.
Well, see, I know it because The Art of Noise, a band in the 80s, did a cover version of this that was very popular in the 80s. This one, when it came out, and this is 19... Okay, Peter Gunn was a TV show. And the synopsis on IMDb, this is the full synopsis. I'm going to read the entire thing.
Oh, boy.
The cases of a stylishly cool private detective.
That's it.
That's it.
That's it.
Okay.
That's all I need to know. I mean, that gave everything away.
This ran 1958 to 1961, three seasons, 114 episodes. This theme, composed by Henry Mancini, who's done a ton of songs.
Great. Yes. Speaking of Hall of Fame.
Yeah, he's really well done. But this one was one where it hit the charts in 1959 and was on the Billboard Hot 100. And then Art of Noise did it in 1986 and it hit the Hot 100 again. So this is one where I think the popularity in the 80s made it more memorable to me. Because I remember seeing a magic show where this magician was like doing these tricks behind a curtain and the song was playing. He had like kind of the spy theme going on. But Peter Gunn isn't one that I'm like, you don't put Peter Gunn up there with like the Mission Impossible guys or James Bond.
Well, but it also didn't get a modern reboot.
No, it hasn't yet.
Like the song may have hit, you know, the charts or whatever, but there's nothing to attach it to.
Yeah.
So unlike Mission Impossible, like that would have faded off into nothing without the Tom Cruise movies.
Yeah. Well, although I think the theme would have stuck around.
The theme, absolutely, because it's perfection. But
I really enjoy this song. It's kind of, it really is kind of that cool little surf. It's not a surf guitar, but it's like
it feels
surf,
that way.
The jazzy bass and the saxophones and everything. Yeah. And so this is one where I'm like, I totally forgot. I thought the song was just called Peter Gunn. And then I was like, oh, there's a show involved with this? That's cool.
Yeah, I've never seen it.
Probably people not. I've never seen an episode.
When I was in high school, I actually played this in band. and I played the low reed instruments. I played the bass clarinet, mm-hmm. and so I was one of the instruments responsible for the did that the entire song, and I got very bored.
You were in band and choir.
Yeah.
What else, Zach? What else are we going to find out?
I drive a Mustang.
Yay!
We talked about that on the Pacon bit. And also, if you have not heard the Art of Noise version, go look it up. There's some weird noise in there. People will know it. It's very
once
80s.
They hear it.
It's so fun, though.
Yeah. Well, I misunderstood this category a little bit. I picked an all-timer.
A lot of confidence.
Yeah.
How is this a forgettable show?
Here's my logic. Okay. I always mix up anything that happened in the Munsters thinking it was the Addams Family.
Yes.
So
I'm right there with you.
The Addams Family, I think, is way better. And don't get me wrong, this show has its moments. But I prefer the Addams Family so much more. But this theme is amazing. Like, it's so cool.
My kids, oh, man. So my kids, this is on our Halloween playlist.
As it should be.
And it's one of the songs we have on heavy rotation in the month of October. But then Fall Out Boy came out with Uma Thurman.
Yeah.
And they have
with the
riff in there.
Weird timing in the song.
And my kids call it the Munster song, and they want to listen to it all the time. But there's some lyrics in there that I'm like, I don't want my kids singing that part of it. So it's just, it's one of those songs that it's a love-hate relationship with. But I'd love the original Munsters version.
Yeah.
Is it better than the Addams Family theme?
No. Well, it's more fun.
It's not as memorable, but I think it's more fun.
It's more fun.
I love how everything has the surf vibe to it.
Yeah, everything in the 60s, you're like, surf guitars.
Well, and that's because, like, if you think about Halloween music, so much of it is just, like, 60s surfer rock.
Yeah.
Because of stuff like this.
Oh, I hadn't thought
about that. So much Halloween music is. And I love this song, but I really
Save for a Halloween music show.
I don't ever think about it in context of the Munsters. I just think, oh, that's a cool song from, what was that show? Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, again, it's an all-timer. It's not like it's a completely forgettable show. I just like the Addams Family better.
I get it.
All right, next up, let's get pumped up with the song that gets you pumped up. What do you think, Joel?
I want to just set the scene here, if I may. You're about to work on a project. Let's say you're going to install a sprinkler. You got your shovel. You got the pipes that you're going to put in. You got the sprinkler head. You got everything you need.
And then I wait to play music until I have all this stuff.
You have your tool belt. You have your tool belt on.
I don't have one. Sure.
And then you crank this up. That project will be done in 10 seconds flat. This is the song from the theme of the A-Team. I should let you guys guess these things, but this was a show 1983, 1987, 5 seasons, 98 episodes. 4 Vietnam vets framed for a crime they didn't commit help the innocent while on the run from the military. This is by Mike Post, once again, who I've talked about before.
Legend.
Which also, he did the themes for Blossom, Doogie Howser, M.D., Silk Stockings. Can't you remember that?
Oh, my gosh.
Wow. But,
just call me out.
But this was one where, oh, man, this theme, you play this, and you really just feel like, I can do anything.
One thing to know is, granted, many of these intros were 30 seconds to a minute long, but there are actual longer versions of these songs, generally from 2 to 4 minutes.
Well, and the one that I had, because like I said, I mentioned this on the last show. Growing up, we had CDs of TV theme songs. And there's like 50 theme songs on one CD. We had like, I don't know, 4 or 5 of them. So I knew all of these themes of songs, TV shows I never even watched. But this one had like all the sound effects in it of like the machine gun fire and like the train
and crashing
through stuff. So it would just get me so pumped up. And I'm not the only one, Kent. TV weatherman Al Roker shared that this is the song he used to get jazzed up in the morning. Quote, get jazzed up.
That's the first time we've mentioned Al Roker on Baconsale.
I don't think it is.
I think it is.
Hey, here's what's happening in your neck of the woods.
And also, this is the one where, I mean, this has been voted number one TV theme from a bunch of different places. I was going around seeing that. And also, it's been used in a bunch of different movies. I remember Napoleon Dynamite used it famously when they're putting up all the posters for the campaign. It's just that very kind of, let's get pumped and do this.
It's a super raw,
it's a project song.
Oh, yeah.
My sprinkler is installed. I'm done.
Already. Even hearing that 10 seconds right there.
Yeah.
Mine is a lot more mellow, but it pumps me up because of...
It's the opposite.
But it...
Once again,
it's
the breaking the rules.
In the context of the show, I feel powerful when I hear this song.
Oh, yeah.
I feel cool. I feel like,
You feel like you want to be a drug kingpin?
Oh, yeah. I feel like I want to
stay out of my territory.
Light a Dodge Challenger on fire.
Wow. So this is obviously Zach.
Breaking Bad.
Yes.
Breaking Bad from 2008 to 2013.
Anything you want to tell us? What else did you do in high school? Chemistry class?
A little bit. No, no, I never did.
This, I'm so glad you brought this up, though.
Yeah.
Because my brother was getting after me because I was talking about how we're doing this show. And he was talking about, well, you got to bring up Breaking Bad. And I'm like,
because we did
and I was
last
like,
time.
I was like, yeah. it's not really a theme song. It sets a mood.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he was like, no, it's a song. And he sent it to me like, you got to listen to this. And I'm so glad you brought it up, though, because now I feel like he's going to leave me alone.
It's weird because it doesn't represent Walter White. It's more the New Mexico environment of everything.
That slide guitar kind
of thing. Like when you actually hear the full version, you know, it's pretty simple. It still stays really mellow, but.
But like the percussion.
It's so cool.
And you almost hear the smoke.
And when, you know, I don't want to spoil anything, but in the show, when it's finally played, this theme is not played within the context of the show until like the next to last episode.
Yeah.
And it is powerful when it does.
Yeah.
And so like I'm even getting goosebumps. So I know it's not like the rah-rah of the A-Team, but it is an awesome, awesome
theme.
There's
some really, really good music in Breaking Bad.
Incredible.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We've already like touted Breaking Bad so many times, but. Thank you, Zack. I even though you kind of botched the category, I still love that you brought up that song. That song is awesome.
So, Zack, you chose one that makes you want to create drugs. Joel, you made one that makes you want to do manual labor.
Yes.
I chose a pumped up one that makes me want to dance.
Fame?
I want to live forever.
This is actually a really good choice. That's awesome. So we all have different pump ups.
We all, by the way, we all did jazz dance fame. And we should have video going because we all just went fireworks.
Man. Oh man.
I promise we're cool.
I think the fireplace in the corner would kind of, you know, dim the camera. I don't know
So Fame was actually not written for the TV show, as we all probably know. This is one of those cases where there was a movie. It came out in 1980. And it was written by Michael Gore and Dean Pitchford, sung by Irene Cara, the original one. It won the Oscar for Best Original Song that year as well. 2 years later, they created a TV show. It went from 1982 to 1987, and the theme was then sung by Erica Gimple, who was also a cast member of the show. And yeah, this song, somehow, I had a couple other choices, but I kept coming back to this one. I'm like, oh my gosh, this one really makes me want to dance.
Is that why you're laying the unitards today?
Yeah, it's a unitard.
Oh, okay. Once again, my hat's off to Alvin and the Chipmunks because I know this one because of them.
Oh, yeah. Really?
And I remember it was like, remember my name, Alvin.
It's like a showboat. Alvin. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
But
real good lyrics.
Yeah.
Well, I love that we all had different motivations for what gets us pumped up.
Yeah.
It says a lot about us, I think. Uh-huh.
But we all have jazz hands universally.
Fame!
The great uniter.
Jazz hands, the great uniter of people. Let's tone things down a bit with the most ominous or creepy. And I'll go first.
Breaking Bad, you already chose it.
Oh,
that'd be so a good choice.
It's such a good choice for that.
Wait, he's going to choose one that he's going to be like, well, I got one here that got me pumped up.
I have one that on a show I've never seen. This is one of those that's on my Halloween
playlist.
I'm
about to be upset with you.
Oh, it's a good one. It's a terrible show, I believe, but it's a cool theme.
Got a secret, can you keep it? Swear this one you save. Better lock it in your
silk
pocket.
Stockings?
No. This is Baywatch. In the
show. Pretty Little Liars.
Oh.
I don't know the show, which was on from...
It's an ABC family show.
Yeah, 2010 to 2017. But this has come up on like playlists and things before. And it starts to get into this like creepy, like carnival doll sort of thing. It gets really quite creepy.
That's an interesting choice because it's not a creepy show, but the theme is creepy.
There's
a secret murderer in the show that stalks everyone.
The
what?
Yeah, a murderer.
Oh, I'm thinking Gossip Girl.
Oh, no,
sorry,
no.
Sorry.
It's kind of the same thing. Kind of
creepy. Yeah, they're covering up a murder.
They all look the same to you, don't they, Joel?
All those CW shows.
So I definitely think it is.
So you would
creepy.
Put this one on a playlist for Halloween?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, and it is on mine just because I was playing it one time at a job. And there was a girl who apparently had seen the show, and she very quickly like ran up to me and said, will you please turn it? That song freaks me out. And
really?
And I didn't even know what we were listening to. And I was like, oh, well, so I looked into the song more because it did. And
I may have to look into that because I'm always looking for new additions to the Halloween playlist.
Yep. It's from Pretty Little Liars.
Okay. And I'm about to go as cliche as you could possibly get with please this do. One.
Tales from the Crypt. Oh, tell me.
Yeah.
You're about to enter another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. A journey into the wondrous land of imagination. Next stop, the Twilight Zone.
You gotta get a little more.
I wanted to erase the music.
Yeah, but I mean, just that. What is his name?
If I could sound like Rod Serling, I would love it.
That little voice.
The dimension of sound. So this one, Twilight Zone, granted, it's an obvious choice.
It's a great choice.
But what it does is each of these episodes puts you almost in this, well, as it says, another dimension, an alternate universe, or the characters in a sort of purgatory world where they really do have to live something out and learn a lesson, and it's generally ironic as well.
Always.
And it just kind of, this music transports you there. Some really fun facts about this song itself. Oh, by the way, five seasons, ran from 1959 to 1964. The original theme was just kind of like background noise, and it still had Rod Serling talking, but that was Bernard Herrmann, who did Psycho, North by Northwest, and Vertigo.
Wow.
And then the showrunners were like, that's really creepy, but we want more. So they got a guy, and his name was Marius Constant. They paid him $500, and he invented...
What is it even played on? What instrument is that?
It's a great question.
I have no idea.
Yeah. Zach, you were in band. Help us out.
I have no idea.
But yeah, so we have that creepy, mysterious space vibe in the back and everything that works together. It really does transport you. And granted, is it scary anymore? Not really.
No, because people use it as an iconic way of being like, something is not right here.
Yes, but if you just all of a sudden heard those kind of tones and you didn't feel like something was quite right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or under the influence, I'm just saying.
What gets me about that song is not necessarily the main theme, which is kind of creepy,
yeah,
but it's everything that's going on around it. The little like
bongos.
Oh, there's so many bongos and stuff. Yeah.
Like, it is very creepy.
It's meant to be disconcerting for the 1950s and 60s.
I love it.
And it still works.
Yeah. It's an all timer.
Yeah.
Love it.
I think it's got to be guitars, right? It's really high on a guitar, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah. Slightly dissonant.
So I chose one. It may not be the most ominous out there, but I knew Kent was never going to pick it, and I think it needed some love here on the show.
Let's hear it.
Nice.
The synth, the feel of 80s creepiness that is in this song, Kent. This is the Stranger Things
dripping through.
This is Stranger Things, the theme, July 2016 to present. I think it's the only to present I'm going to have on the show.
Yeah.
Three seasons, 25 episodes. Synopsis: when a young boy disappears, his mother, a police chief, and his friends must confront terrifying supernatural forces in order to get him back. Now, we already talked about on episode 226, soundtrack and fears.
And Stranger Influences as well.
We did, but we talked about the Walking Dead theme and the X-Files theme, which were both like on my short list.
Mm-hmm.
But then I came back to this one and I was like, I gotta give it some love, because I remember the first time that theme came on, I was like, this is my childhood. This is my scary movie childhood.
Yes.
And this, the way the credits come in and everything and piece together.
Yeah. It's crafted so well.
I was going to say, I think I like the credits like tied with it a little bit more.
Yeah.
And I like just the song alone, because I'm immediately picturing the neons.
Yeah, the red coming
red
in.
Letters.
Yeah.
It's so good.
So this is composed by Kyle Dixon and Michael Sine of the electronic band Survive, which no one's ever heard of Survive, but you have heard this song.
They did the Rocky soundtracks, right?
Yes, they Survivor.
Oh.
But this was one where they had kind of this loose version of it originally, kind of, and I couldn't find
it. Probably like a longer like dubstep version.
Well, I was looking for like the original one this came from, but apparently it was just kind of this unreleased track. And then they were looking through their songs, were like, what about this one? They're like, could you flesh out a bit? And then they turned it into this kind
what
of
a great find
thing,
because it sets the tone.
It does. Yeah. And I really enjoy it. And like other people, like I know Blink-182 has used this at their live performances sometimes, which I'm like, it doesn't seem like a Blink-182 thing, but at least it's cool that they
You mean actual good music's played at a Blink show? Wondering.
Hey.
Nice. Come on. Can you dispute it?
No.
I do like some Blink-182 music.
Not in concert.
That's true.
Save it for the concert.
I've never seen Blink-182 in concert. Bad. I saw Angels and Airwaves.
Yeah.
And they were terrible. But no, this won the Enemy Award for Outstanding Main Theme Title Music in 2017. And I think appropriately, because if this one, honestly, this is one of those ones where if I was in a dark alleyway and this started playing
like far in the distance almost, like it's really quiet,
or like just kind of ominous, I'd be like, what is happening right now?
You'd be thinking you were chased by something,
or I'd be like, who's watching Stranger Things?
can I watch season 2? I'm okay.
I start creeping in their windows. What episode? Oh, season 2, episode 10. I'm out.
That's the thing, I like the theme way more than I like the show.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, season 1 maybe not, but
I think I like the show. I think it really did set the mood for
good compatibility.
Where like when that started up, I'm like, okay, I'm in. This is going to be good.
I think between Stranger Things and Breaking Bad, those are the only two on Netflix that I don't skip the theme of.
Yeah.
Like I never skip the theme for Stranger Things. It's just too good.
It's so much fun.
Great choice. How about, this is a little bit of a weird one. Best original song in a show, but the song is not the theme of the show. What do you got, Kent?
I could go many places with this, but I just had to hurry and choose because I didn't want to spend a lot of time thinking about like when they have musical episodes of certain sitcoms. So I just want to go for a show where I like this song and I wish it was the theme. okay. more than the actual theme of the show. I'm not sure this show actually has a theme. But Joel, get ready, because...
Toss a coin to no, your goal. Witcher, O Valley no. of Plenty.
I hate this show.
I have no concept of what you guys are doing right now.
Good choice, Ken.
It's at the end of episode 2, and what I find... Oh, so this is from The Witcher, and it is the song. It is probably the most viral thing about The Witcher, other than Henry Cavill going...
And saying a word we don't say on the show.
A bad one. Actors who are now have viruses.
Yeah, that's true. But this song came out in episode 2, and everyone's like, what? The internet took notice. YouTube covered it like crazy. This song has tens of millions of views itself and is now like this established karaoke song as well. It was actually written by the screenwriter of the second episode. Her name is Jenny Klein, and she's like, I want to make sure there's a reason for Geralt, who is the main character, to travel with a bard, who is Haskier. Who is probably the best character of the show.
Yeah.
And so she's like...
You stop it right now.
No, hold on. I like it. Let me explain it backwards.
No,
Bard,
no, no.
Geralt, travel, song.
Stop it.
Witcher coin. I mean, that's pretty much the logic of it.
Yeah.
But so she went to the book series and read all about it. And like, Geralt's never actually paid for the tasks that he does. And so she gave the Bard a reason to exist. Pay the Witcher. He does all these things for you. Pay him and give him a drink. The song is actually really pretty. And what I love most about music,
voice is so
it
good.
Escalates so well. I just played the end there, so it kind of comes in like really strong. But it escalates so well.
Yeah, when it's just him playing on his little
when
whatever.
Humble Bard. Yeah.
Oh, it's so...
I'm shocked. Ken, I am shocked.
I know. See, I didn't spend a lot of time on this one because I could have spent deep dive on this one forever. So I'm just
shocked you didn't go Light of the Seven.
We couldn't.
You could.
Mm-mm.
You used the theme for Game of Thrones. You could have used Light
of the
Seven.
Oh, mad.
Loophole.
That's originally why I wanted this category.
That's what I thought. I thought for sure you were going to pick that.
My choice is Light of the Seven from Game of Thrones.
Thank you. It's much better than that Witcher crap.
It's no Witcher.
Can I have your Witcher choice? Because it's way better than mine.
Okay, yeah. You take that one. I'll take Light of the Seven because that is a phenomenal song. I just didn't want to choose it because we did Game of Thrones
but
in the last episode.
But we did the Game
episode.
Of Thrones theme. We've already used the song.
Man, I need to find more loopholes.
The rule is if we use the song last time, we can't use it again. But just because we used one of the songs, I mean, it's got a whole
thing. Excuse me, there's something in my eye.
Oh, wow. Wow, I'm sorry. I did not mean to take away your choice because I was really hoping we were going to
Light
of the Seven.
No, if I played Light of the Seven, it would have been a 7-minute stretch before we said a word.
I know, you'd been like, no.
Because that song escalates and the story it tells, even by music, is so good.
Yeah. I've never even seen the show and I've heard the song.
I was actually just going to ask, I wonder if people know Light of the Seven.
I do.
Who can appreciate
or Reigns of Castamere, for example.
Without seeing what happened in that moment when that
Reigns of Castamere, too. Joel,
yeah.
What's your choice before I go into a Game of Thrones tangent?
Dang it. I'm going to bring the room down with this. I'm sorry.
Oh, so Zach's going to get pumped up.
I hate you.
I had a feeling.
I want you to just try to listen to this without looking wistfully off in the distance.
Here's what's happening right now. Charlie is bringing pudding to Claire.
Claire.
Claire's holding
her baby.
We're
telling Shannon that Boone didn't make it.
Where's my baby?
Not Penny's boat.
Saeed is patting Hurley on the back.
Because this is called Life and Death.
Is this,
and this is from the show Lost.
Lost. Is this the song they played at like pretty much the end of every episode that where they wanted to have a message?
This played almost every dead or dying characters.
Oh, is that
like,
true?
Like whenever there's a major death or something like that, or like a birth, they would play this song. And a lot of times, the thing I love about Lost is that every character has a theme, like a kind of music that accompanies them. Mm-hmm. And with this song, Life and Death, when one of the major characters would die, they would interweave Life and Death, the song, with their theme and create this whole new song. So it was like their theme.
So
plus
you being
other
a super fan, do you know people's themes?
Not as well as I should. It's been a long time, so I really got to do a rewatch on this.
Me too.
By the way, if you haven't seen Lost, 2004 to 2010, 6 seasons, 121 episodes.
But Joel, it only went for a season and a half.
Oh, shush.
Oh, stop.
Survivors of a plane crash are forced to work together in order to survive on a seemingly deserted tropical island. This was composed by Michael Giacchino.
Yeah.
And
masterful.
It's just this weird. Okay, so it has this beautiful, sad, sad music. And then at the end, it has a very Lost kind of a.
What is that? It's like, oh, it's so foreboding.
I know. I almost wish it wasn't there because it's such a sad, melodic tune. But this honestly,
because it always leads into the what's happening elsewhere.
And it does, because everything is that.
Yeah. That was Ben.
I actually looked on the Lostopedia or whatever it was. This is in about 30 different scenes throughout the show. This is the life and death theme.
Okay.
It really makes me sad. Like when I listened to it again, I just got kind of my shoulders slumped and kind of just my head went down. And I was just like,
because you love the character so much.
Because it brought back so many emotions. This theme.
It is weird because we joked about this on the last TV theme show where the intro to Lost is.
Yeah.
And that's it. And it shows the Lost title.
But it worked.
And then all of a sudden in the shows, it's very good music.
Yeah. And Michael Giacchino, he's done a ton of music.
Like he's doing the upcoming The Batman.
Well, he is. And he's also worked on multiple Mission Impossible movies. Mm-hmm. He did Ghost Protocol number 3. He did music for Incredibles, Up, Ratatouille, Cars, Cars 2, Coco, Inside Out, Super 8, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, Doctor Strange, Rogue Spider-Man One. Far From Home, Spider-Man Homecoming, Jojo Rabbit. He did also music for Medal of Honor and Call of Duty.
Well, he started in Alias and Fringe. He started in video games, and The Incredibles was his first like movie. But imagine that's your first movie.
And
The Incredibles
theme
is amazing.
He nailed it.
Yeah, he's
so the thing is, this guy's very talented. And if you haven't listened to the score of Lost, even if you don't want to watch the show, just listen to the score, and you'll still be highly entertained.
I'm going to play this at your funeral.
Please do.
And then it's going to have that foreboding note where one of your eyes will open.
No, it needs to have like a little thing below my body, like props me up right at the end.
He just starts breathing as heavy as Jack. My choice is going to just be ridiculous. Your after all this.
Best original song, but it's not the theme.
And the dancing.
I love that you chose Let's Go to the Mall.
Let's go to the mall.
Robin when? Sparkles.
Today.
Blind Spot.
What?
How I Met Your Mother? Blind Spot. I've seen this music video because you sent it to me, but I've never watched the show.
Annually, I send it to you. Annually, I send it to you.
And Robin Sparkles videos?
I want you to go to the mall with me.
I was going to talk about another one that's a little bit less family friendly. I was going
Robin
to pick,
Daggers?
Nothing Suits Me Like a Suit. Love that one. It was actually my ringtone for like a year and a half.
Is that from the musical episode?
No. It's just he just starts doing.
Barney just does a musical number at one point.
It's Neil Patrick Harris, so he just decided.
So the show is?
The show is How I Met Your Mother. It ran all except for the last episode. Dun, dun, dun. So it had seasons.
The last season.
And then there was an entire last season.
Skip the last
season. It's weird how they canceled it.
Yeah, 2005 to definitely not 2014. There was a few different songs in there. There were some running gags in there. But that definitely is a fun one.
And I do enjoy the main theme for this song, too. Like, it's one that it's a fun, peppy song. I never skip that one either.
No, it's good.
But this is
it's quick, too.
This is a fantastic choice, Zach. I like that you chose this.
Thank you for... I had one.
That episode of the Robin Sparkles reveal is one of my favorite episodes of the show.
They think she did something bad.
Yeah. And then it turns out she was just in an embarrassing music
video. Like a Canadian pop star, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And the joke is that the 90s took like an extra decade to reach Canada.
So it's like they're 2 years behind.
Or the 80s. Still there. Yeah, the 80s.
Yeah. So that's a good choice.
Next up, we have the one you get mixed up with another one.
Gentlemen, I'm going to propose a test for this one. Are you ready? Are you ready for the test?
Do I have to name that tune because I'm going to fail?
Band Matters.
Right?
Full House.
Wait. Here we go.
Hold on.
Ready for the test?
Is this Full House?
Step by step.
Okay, sing Full House. Go. Sing Full House.
Everywhere you
look. No, from the beginning.
It's a rare
condition. Whatever happened to do step by step. Do step by step.
I can't remember now. It's so confusing.
Because this one is from Family Matters. As Days Go By, Family Matters ran from 1989 to 1998. 9 seasons, 215 episodes. And it was sung by Jesse Frederick, who did Perfect Strangers, Full House, Family Matters, and Step by Step. Same guy did all those.
So much
and he sang a bunch of those too. The song originally, by the way, they had What a Wonderful World by Louis Armstrong for like the first 5 episodes of the first season.
What?
Well, Family Matters was a different show. It wasn't the Steve Urkel show.
No, not yet.
It's just meant to be about the Winslows. Yeah.
But the thing is, I watched the opening credits, and it's the same kind of goofy freeze frames.
What a Wonderful World?
Yes, with What a Wonderful World.
With the freeze frames?
And it was like I was watching an in memoriam of these people. Like, it really was not tonally right for the show. And so watching it that way and then watching it with the updated version, I'm like, yeah, they definitely made the right move here. Because they only went, like I said, 5
episodes.
But
it's the same song.
It feels like it. I get it mixed up all the time with Full House. So people start singing and I'm like, make it better second time. Nope, that's Step by Step. So yeah, I wanted to do that test to you because I wanted to know it's not just me who gets confused with this song and Full House particularly, but all the time. I get it mixed up all the time.
And it's always like B-roll.
yeah,
with Penny and on the house, whether it's in San Francisco.
Yeah. So here's the thing.
And the same yellow text.
Yeah. Fun fact. It's they're panning in with What a Wonderful World, and it's one continuous long slow shot. Mm-hmm. When they do the As Days Go By version, they jump cut, so it's like to make it a little more peppy.
Good,
so,
good.
That's a great choice. I want to do a quiz. I want you guys to guess what song this is.
Perfect Strangers.
Is it Full House?
It's a Perfect Strangers. In this day and age,
So for all the same reasons, I completely agree. This sounds like
it's the same raspy voice.
Yeah, everything else. So very good choice, Joel. I had the same one. Family Matters.
Jeez, Family Matters.
Leave us alone. Magic.
Although we didn't mention Family Matters once in the last episode, so we kind of have to now.
Because you mentioned Full House, and this is like the sort of lesser version.
Yeah,
yeah.
Real love bursting out.
I just want to sing it now,
which is why I chose.
Oh, come on!
We all chose that one.
That's great. How could we not?
I cannot believe we all chose that one. I was hoping there was some other song out there.
Like, there are some, like, Party of Five has some that feel like...
California!
No, you stop that right now.
Five?
No.
Oh.
Closer to Free.
Yeah.
But anyways, there's a lot of shows
I
like
don't
that.
Wait.
Yes, a lot of that too. Like a lot of teen dramas sound the same, but nothing is more similar than these TGIF songs.
And even just the music, but the intros are all the same. It's the same style. It's like they used an iMovie template and just filled in shots.
But it worked.
It really
did
work.
Like you watch TGIF, you're like, yeah, there's my favorite character.
Which is weird because then Boy Meets World is like a really bland theme, mm-hmm. and it should just been the same exact guy.
I'm really trying to remember the Perfect Strangers theme song now. Standing tall on the wings of my dreams. Save for another show. We have not used it.
We probably won't.
We probably won't. It's one of my favorites.
Sure.
What's a song that sounds like a tier 3 version of another
How
song?
How dare you, sir?
Pretty much.
I'll show you. We made a Divine Comedy opening with that music.
You're not going to win me over with Divine Comedy, Joel.
You should watch it.
It's on
YouTube.
Next up, we have, what do these lyrics have to do with the show? Here is my choice.
Aw.
I just don't know what
has nothing to do.
No, it totally does. It totally does.
And it only applies if you once like the show.
I never so much
falls on. Come on, never skipped over this
one. I love this one.
It's a great theme.
I actually Dandy Warhols. I downloaded this.
The lyrics don't work.
It does.
It doesn't at all because it's like
the whole point of the show first season is Veronica has fallen out of grace with her friends.
No, it feels like a looking back, like 5 years ago, 10 years ago.
Oh, a long time ago, we used to be friends, but I haven't thought of you lately.
This only applies as if you liked Veronica Mars back in the day, and you're like, I'm going to rewatch that. My old friends
by
on TV.
By the way,
TV.
Zach, the show is?
Veronica Mars.
Yeah.
But no, I totally think it works because I was like, it's like ever since Veronica Mars' friend Lily Kane was murdered, she'd fallen out of grace with her friends, and that's why we used to be friends a long time ago. Mm. I thought it worked.
When the song like hits its peak, it shows Enrico Colantini or whatever, her dad, and it's like, oh, your dad is your friend they used to know back a long time ago?
Yeah.
Well, they got estranged too.
And then it made a lot of sense in the like the rebooted season in 2019.
They did like a noir sad version of it too.
Yeah. Oh, I haven't seen that one.
It was
like of the theme.
Mm-hmm. The updated theme is bad.
It's not good.
Oh.
No, and I think they tried to even update it in third season. I can't remember, but
yeah.
No, I really enjoy this.
The main song is a really good song, but I just don't get the connection to that show.
In fact, I am going to remove that from my ones that I wanted to use for next time because you've now stolen it and I can no longer use
Joel
it.
Joel loves Veronica Mars. Well, season 1 and 2.
Yes.
I think it is fine.
What a review.
It's fine.
It is fine.
Yep. There are parts that are enjoyable.
All right. My choice is... probably one of the worst songs for a great show.
Yeah.
And I personally feel the lyrics don't fit.
Hey, baby, I hear the blues are calling. Toss salads and scrambled eggs.
Quite styling.
Yeah, maybe.
I got you pegged. Salad and scrambled eggs.
This doesn't scream.
Hold on. They're calling again. Hold on, but listen to this part.
Scrambled eggs all over my face. What is a boy to do?
What is a boy to do? So this is Frank.
Get in Seattle!
11 what? Seasons, 1993 to 2004. There was an interview last year with the song composer, Bruce Miller, and they said, what the heck is going on with those lyrics? He said, well, it's clear. It's an old bluesy jazz song that could be sung by Mel Torme. And listen to the lyrics. They make sense. So, hey, baby, I hear the blues a-callin'. People with blues are a Colin Fraser, right?
Oh. Like stretch there, buddy.
And then tossed salad and scrambled eggs. These people are confused. They're basically scrambled. And Fraser has them pegged. He gets a little confused, but then he has them pegged.
This is really a stretch.
And they're calling again. And I'm sorry, scrambled eggs all over my face. What's a boy to do?
He's a messy eater.
It's just like they're like, hey, Kelsey Grammer, what you got? What did you have for lunch and breakfast yesterday? Toss salad and scrambled eggs, I guess. Sing about it and make it a song for a very well-written TV show. Frasier is very enjoyable.
It's great.
But this song has nothing to do with it. I'm sorry, Bruce Miller, you're wrong and you're a liar.
Such a positive show today.
So I just, this song is so weird.
Thank you, Joel.
Having your star of your TV show sing the theme is already a little weird. But then having him sing about tossed salad and scrambled eggs and laugh maniacally, it does not fit Frasier.
Yeah.
Like the show, Frasier. Honestly, though, like after a while, you get kind of used to it being there. Have the little jazzy thing in the background. What is a boy to do? This is like the opposite. Remember, last time we talked about the show that perfectly told the story of what the show is about.
Yeah,
like,
the expositional
Brady Bunch,
one.
Gilligan's Island, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But this one, I honestly listened to it and I was like, that has nothing to do with it.
Imagine if on his radio show, where he is a therapist, if that was the intro for his radio show and people were calling him asking for advice, they'd be like, you're a crazy person.
Yeah.
Imagine, too, you've just finished watching Cheers, which, as we decided on, as you decided on the last show, is the best theme ever.
It's been decided. It's Baconsale approved,
which is gospel.
Yeah. Right. And then you go, oh, well, I guess I'll watch this show about just Frasier. Like, oh, I knew I never liked that guy.
But it does feel kind of very Frasier-ish. Like, honestly, I feel like it's Frasier singing the theme song, not Kelsey Grammer.
Yeah.
Or Beast. It could be Beast.
Beast. I tend to think it's Beast.
Yeah.
He played X-Men.
He played Scrooge in a TV movie musical once.
Oh, good. I'm glad we've agreed on two categories in a row. Yeah. We gotta mix up this next one.
Again, very positive show today. Worst theme song for the best show.
All right. My choice. And Jake, I'm sorry you're not here.
Supernatural.
This is for Justified.
Gallivan? Oh, Justified.
Yeah, Justified. Think of the three shows that Jake likes.
Yeah, it was one of them.
Yeah, this definitely is.
So, Justified. I mean, we do have, like, the bluegrass twang.
Yeah, what do you not like about this?
Well, it's written by a group named Gangsta Grass, and they combine authentic bluegrass and rap into a new genre they've created, which, look, like I said, bluegrass does fit the show. He is a sheriff from Miami that gets pulled into the sticks, basically.
Goes back to his hometown.
He lays down the law. Hmm. But all of a sudden, they're trying to make it a modern sort of Western. But I'm sorry, the rap doesn't fit anywhere in the show. This is like the Dixie Mafia in the show.
Have you even seen Hamilton?
This was actually in the Hamilton soundtrack. Yeah. They had to cut it out. But yeah, this show went for 6 seasons, and it just doesn't work. Like, it's on this lonely road, trying to make it home, doing it by my lonesome, ticked off, who wants some? I'm fighting before my soul. Get at your boy. It just doesn't fit.
Well, now
who
I hate
character
it.
Is. Yeah.
Hey,
that's the widest rendition of that song ever happened.
It was.
Gangsta Grass featuring now, Kent.
I would like to clarify mine because it's worst theme song for best show. So there are some bad shows with bad theme songs out there.
Right. So you had to find a good show.
Most of the shows I like the theme song as well. It was actually interesting to me to see how most good shows have a good theme song.
Yeah.
It's hard to find that difference there, that dichotomy. But so this is relatively like how much I like the show versus how much I like
Understood.
The song.
I'm exactly the same way on mine.
I'm not hating on this song.
Sure.
Please, please don't come at me.
Oh, no.
Don't at me.
Oh, okay. I thought you were choosing another one.
No. This is Where You Leave as the theme song from Gilmore Girls.
Did you not sing along every time this was on?
This is literally the show that made me grateful for the skip intro button. Because this song, I don't know, like, I just never, it didn't feel like Gilmore Girls to me. I know a lot of people have that association, and it's become the Gilmore Girls song for
them. It's like white girl gospel.
Yeah. Kind of is.
Yeah.
Dixie
so
chicks.
Is the show. Yeah.
Or just Gilmore chicks. Girls, by the way, ran from 2000 to 2007. Seven seasons and a bonus season. 157 episodes. It's a dramedy centering around the relationship between a 30-something single mother and her teen daughter living in Stars Hollow, Connecticut.
See, I feel like when you watch the show, you're already gaining estrogen. And when that intro starts, like your Y chromosome just kind of crawls away.
Well,
it does fit. But it's also a really bad song that could just be on some bad radio station.
And it was. It was like some adult contemporary whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The problem is that I started doing the research for this song. I was like, oh, that's kind of cute.
Oh, no.
Because this Carole King did the song.
Oh, great.
Originally, she did the song.
Yeah.
But then they said, hey, can we use this? I think what they were asking for another song of hers. But she's like, what if I do a remake of this one? But instead of the love relationship, I'll sing it with my daughter and I'll rewrite the lyrics to be a mother-daughter song. And that's what
now
they
now I have
into.
To like it.
Oh, it's kind of cute. And so then they played the song, but I really, every time the credits would come on, I was like, ah, not this song. Let's get back to the fun show that I enjoy.
Remember when Netflix didn't have a skip intro button?
I know.
And now they do. It's so nice. Now they will just automatically sometimes.
Yeah. Empire.
If you do it enough. I always notice with The Office, because it's like very aggressive at the end.
So once
like,
again, please don't come at me.
Don't plead.
Gilmore Girl fans will kill me for saying it's not a good song.
Hey, Gilmore Girl fans that listen to Baconsale, that small segment, wherever you are, speak up now.
All both
no,
of you.
No. I love the show. The song.
Save it for the
what
Gilmore
is it? The Venn
show.
Diagram? I really want to know.
Yeah. We can do the Gilmore Girl show?
Stop it.
Zack,
right
we can do
now.
The Gilmore Girl show.
Bacon no. Gilmore Girl show.
Nope. Stop it.
I want to be the novice.
I want to be the novice.
Too late.
I'm hey, so
you've
mad.
Already seen some.
Please, someone sign up for Patreon and do a Gilmore Girl show.
Oh, no. Joel will.
All right, same logic. I don't hate the song, and I really, really like the show, but I just never really liked the theme so much on this one. I can't
do this all. Oh!
Is this from Scrubs?
I'm no Superman.
Taking that off my honorable mention.
I just remember thinking, wow, I'm glad this is generally pretty short.
It usually is.
I mean, it's a fine enough song. I like the song okay. I definitely am glad it's short.
They definitely had...
And I really like the show.
I think they definitely had a tone for music in the show. Like, they always kind of chose kind of the cool hit of the time.
Mm-hmm. Or really indie artists.
I think it was mostly Zach Braff's playlist.
It was.
He just chose that and chose... I think we should put this song in here. This sappy, sad song.
Which I do feel like the intro fits the songs he chose in the show. Because they're always a bit sappy and indie.
I wouldn't use this for like doesn't fit the show or doesn't I just don't really like it a lot as compared to the show. Now next up we have You Know the Song But You Didn't Watch the Show.
I don't think I ever watched the show because I have no concept of it, but I could sing every word of this.
Baby, if you've ever wondered whatever became of me, Cincinnati,
WKRP. Can I cut it here? I'm on WKRP in Cincinnati.
That was lovely.
So WKRP in Cincinnati ran from 1978 to 1982, four seasons, 90 episodes. The synopsis is the misadventures of the staff of a struggling top 40 rock radio station in Cincinnati, Ohio. It's not a full sentence, but we'll go with that.
You never watched this.
I never watched it. But this song, I don't know why. And it was released as a single, and it did peak at number 65 on the Billboard Hot 100 and 29 on the Adult Contemporary chart in 1982. But I don't know why this song, of all songs, cemented in my brain as a kid.
It's a pretty cool song.
Yeah, I like it.
But how?
I've never seen the show either.
Oh. Yeah.
This is one, too, where also the song was so popular that they ended up making various letters to different radio stations around the country where they do the jingle at the end and use their call sign, their numbers.
Oh, that's cool.
So
that's
it was
cool,
like WGAR in Cleveland or something like that. And they just had that in the air. But yeah, I don't know why. WKRP in Cincinnati? I've never seen an episode, but that song, it's never leaving my head.
No.
This next one for me is, I actually realized this is on my shame list of shows I've never seen. It's a great theme.
Well, we're moving on up.
This is the Jeffersons theme.
This is my honorable mention, by the way.
The Jeffersons running from 1975 to 1985.
It's not a very good show.
It's like a never classic. A
no.
Really?
But the thing is, I know the theme song too, but I've never seen an episode. I saw clips. I saw a lot of clips of this one. But I've never seen like a full episode of it.
I've never seen the show, and I think that theme is fantastic.
It is a good theme.
It's a great
theme. I've listened to it many a time.
Zack, you were talking about shame. I should be ashamed of never seeing this show, considering a lot of the Nick at Night shows I have seen in this same era. And it's...
What?
I'm sorry.
Hello world, here's a song for singing. Come on, get happy.
You never watched The Partridge Family?
Never did. Brady Bunch, I've seen every episode a few times.
I mean, I'm not saying I'm a Partridge Family fan, but I've seen episodes.
I've seen them sing at the end of some episodes because they always ended it. They were traveling in the first season especially, and they'd always end in a song that would bring everyone together after some misadventures or something going wrong with their equipment. But all I knew is like, yeah, this mom and her kids were traveling around singing songs. And I was like, you know, a little too cheesy for me. I'm okay seeing Jan get hit with it, or Marsha.
That was your childhood growing up.
It was. I was first tenor.
I knew it.
And Danny Bonaducci was there.
He probably was.
He probably was. Weirdo. But this show ran from 1970 to 74. Sorry, Danny Bonaducci. He is a weirdo.
His cousin may listen to the show.
Well, Rich, we've done a TV show together. Anyways, Shirley Jones plays a widowed mother who embarks with her five children on a music career. You guys watch this a fair amount?
Not a fair amount. Like, I know
several episodes.
Yeah, I've seen several episodes.
And the movie?
There's probably a movie. Not a theatrical
like
movie,
a TV
but
movie.
A TV movie.
Yeah, totally.
See, I always made those for cheap. But yeah, never did. I'm a little ashamed, but I still will probably never watch it.
No, you probably won't. I know.
Come on, Kent. Get happy.
Never. I love this next category. This one is the most toe-tappable. And I submit that I have the correct choice.
I'm tapping.
It's a lovely song.
It's a head bobber.
It really is.
I don't know if it's a toe tapper, but it's a head
bobber.
I'm
tapping my toes and I'm a head
bobber. I'm clenching my toes.
Now, wait a minute, youngin.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, youngin.
I love the Andy Griffith show.
Have you seen the Andy Griffith show?
Yes.
Okay,
little Ronnie Howard. Oh. Yes. It's from the Andy Griffith show, which ran from 1960 to 1968, and apparently has Matlock in it.
Apparently,
it's called the Andy Griffith Show.
When I made that connection later in life, I was like, wait a second.
I just love how they like call it the Andy Griffith Show when he's not even playing Andy Griffith show. He's Andy Taylor.
Yeah, it's
strange. He's the draw.
But I love that song. It makes me happy every time. I like to whistle it, and I think it's quite a toe tapper.
All right, mine is better. Sorry.
No, come on.
I went through a couple on this one, ton of honorable mentions, but when I played this song, and I didn't think I'd choose it, but when I played it, I couldn't stop smiling.
Okay.
Mr. Belvedere?
Get ready. Here we go. You ready to tap your toes?
Drinks on the china, never mattered before. Who cares when you drop, kick your jacket, and you came in the door? No one glared. But sometimes things get turned around and no one's spared. All hands look out below. There's a change in the status quo.
I'm going the full song.
You are. All the help that we can get. Oh, that is my favorite part.
According to our new arrival, life is more than just survival. And we just might live a good life yet.
So beautiful, so fun.
I had that one, Kent, for my random lyrics one.
But it actually appeals to
it
this song.
It was more so than tossed salad and scrambled eggs.
No, because I actually thought this song was Streets in China. I was like, wait, Streets in China, but it's Streaks on the China. He plays their butler.
Mm-hmm.
And so everything is like, dropkick your jacket, no one cares. Right. Oh, wait, I have to clean that up. New arrival. It's all about Mr. Belvedere. But this song made me smile the
whole way through.
From 1985 to 1990.
I watched so many episodes of Mr. Belvedere. And like, it's one of those shows
that no
one talks about it anymore.
No. Christopher Hewlett plays Mr. Belvedere. This theme song, also written by Gary Portnoy, who is now in the Hall of Fame for TV themes, sung by Leon Redbone. So it's got that real ragtime feel.
Yeah.
Clearly of the bad impression that we did. I don't remember too many episodes of this. I just remember Bob Uecker, who was just talking about sports all the time. But I remember the episode... Wesley's Friend. And I don't want to talk about it too much because I feel like I'm going to talk about another episode, but that's the episode where I learned about AIDS.
Wow.
Do you remember this episode?
This is taking another dark turn.
Wesley's friend comes over and they're like, hey, buddy, how are you? And he says, well, I got AIDS, but other than that, I'm doing pretty good. It was the 80s.
80s did that a lot. Well, I mean, that was the time when they were talking about
it. No, but it's a very special episode as well.
Yeah.
But I love that theme.
What
do you got, Joel?
I got one I think you're going to agree with.
It's because it's the correct choice.
It's a finger snapper.
No, I was going to say, I was tapping my toes on this one. And I when you started playing it, I was like, oh, man, he took it. He took it. Then I was like, it makes perfect sense. This is the fishing hole.
Yeah.
This is the song called The Fishing Hole. You hear that, you're like, oh, yeah. I'm out in the... This is just nice. A nice time. And in fact, did you guys know that this song actually has lyrics?
Yes.
Go on.
That when they wrote the song, they actually wrote it with lyrics initially. It was written by Earl Hagen and Herbert Spencer. Earl Hagen, a very popular writer of music, but Herbert Spencer actually collaborated with John Williams. He was the orchestrator and arranger for films such as Star Wars, E.T., Indiana Jones.
Like, really?
He worked on that with John Williams. But I do have here, I have a clip of the lyrics, so you can hear actually the lyrics for The Fishing Hole for that show. It's actually Andy Griffith singing it.
Well, now take down your fishing pole and meet me at the fishing hole. We may not get a bite all day, but don't you rush away. What a great place to rest your bones and mighty fine for skipping like, stones.
What? It's a toe tapper. You're bobbing your head. I can see it.
I mean, the song is good. I don't know about the voice with the Andy Griffith
show. Well, the
show.
Thing is, it was more
I just
is,
do the whistle.
It's quaint. Like, you hear that, you're like, oh, that's cute. But yeah, I totally agree. The toe tapple. I'm glad we agreed on that.
Yeah.
I thought it was going to be like one of those that just stand out there being like, come on, guys, remember that old show? Remember that old show?
Really? Andy Griffith is classic.
But a lot of people have totally forgotten about it.
I was going to
go, Sheriff Barney, that's about it.
Now from most toe tappable to most annoying. What do you got, Kent?
I hate this song. And I haven't seen the full series, but I've seen too many episodes, and I'll tell you why in just a second. You guys may not know it, and I hope you don't. For your souls.
Girls on film.
Top model?
No.
What the heck is this?
Must-see TV.
Oh, is this Christy Alley's... Veronica's Closet.
Veronica's Closet. Kirstie Alley. Gross. This went for 3 seasons. This song gives me anxiety. Like, even hearing it right now, I'm like, please stop. Please, nails on a chalkboard. So this was must-see TV, and so many people watched this because it was put right between Seinfeld and ER on must-see TV. Mm-hmm. And remember, Thursday night was where it was at.
Yeah.
And they'd always try to launch new shows in between, like, Friends and Seinfeld, and then ER followed. So there was always, like, 2 shows that might be canceled, and then this one eventually was, because after 2 seasons of doing really well, 3rd season they put it on Monday with Suddenly Susan, and both shows were canceled that year, which...
It's a lot of sense. In your face. That theme is very in your face. And the opening credits, if I remember right, it's just her going crazy in front of the camera.
Yeah, like, and then it has Dan Cortez.
Yeah.
Just doing dumb stuff.
Cortez?
Cortez?
I think it's Cortez.
It's Cortez.
Is it Cortez?
Someone let us know if it's Cortez, Cortezzi, or Cortez.
MTV's Dan Cortez.
But I hate the song. It really does give me anxiety. Never watch the show. Never listen to this again. I may cut this out of the show.
No, I agree. So like when I cut these clips, when I go through and listen to the things and then cut them out, I listen to them all again. And I enjoy having kind of just the songs playing in the background. When this song came on, I skipped. I was like, nope, I'm not even. I'll just assume it's good and move on because I don't want to hear this again.
Oh, boy. How dare you?
How? You think it's patriotic? You think it's Yankee Doodle? No. This is nails on a chalkboard for me. This is Barney and Friends ran from 1992 to 2009.
I don't mind this one.
14 seasons, 268 episodes, and I had little cousins who loved this and watched it all the time. And I would have to hear that ridiculous theme song
over
and over again.
Did you not salute the purple dinosaur?
Is that a drug euphemism?
There's no way this is worse than Lamb Chops Play Along.
I like that.
Lamb Chops way
that's
worse.
A game. That's
worse.
A game to see how long you can sing that with your friends.
Without bashing your head
This
in.
Is like, hey, we got no real music. How about we just use Yankee Doodle and then use rhymes like, Barney is a dinosaur from our imagination, and when he's tall, he's what we call a dinosaur sensation.
He's a dinosaur sensation, Joel.
How is he a dinosaur sensation?
Why is Bill Clinton watching dinosaurs?
I don't want to know.
I didn't say I watched anything.
Jeez. The 90s or so.
But I just, this song, it really is. Like, most Barney songs, and this is definitely came at a time when I was, like, getting to be, like, too cool. Like,
well, you were too old for this show.
Yeah. Right, but then my
cousins... But you have children.
My cousins watched it, and I honestly, I wouldn't let my kids watch it because I was so annoyed by this song.
They didn't never learned how to clean up, clean up.
We well, sing that. We sing that
everywhere.
I think this theme is inoffensive because of I love you, which is you way worse. Me. That's way worse.
Nope. Save for a closing credit show.
I'll just tell you a quick story about my parents. They didn't want me to watch Barney. They didn't want to put up with
they
it.
They didn't want you to salute the purple dinosaur.
No. So they told me that Barney was an alcoholic.
He was.
So I didn't like him, and so I wouldn't watch the show.
I think the first guy in there, I think, was an alcoholic. Wait, so did you judge Barney for being an alcoholic?
Yeah. I was like, then I don't want to watch that.
So your parents just saying, like, it's not that good of a show. They're like, oh, yeah, that guy's an alcoholic. Hey, that purple dinosaur is an alcoholic.
Son, use your righteous judgment on this purple dinosaur.
So they got me to say, Zack, why don't you watch Barney? Because he's an alcoholic.
He's got real issues. No oh one says gosh. I want to grow up and be a junkie when they get older.
Exactly. Oh, so I never really watched much
Peppa
of it.
Pig. She makes methamphetamine.
Hey, she got cancer and needs to help her family.
I got real pumped up by Peppa Pig.
Wow.
Quote unquote. Fun facts.
Sorry, kids. Oh, man.
That took a turn.
It did.
All right, and here's my pick.
How can you follow that other pick?
I can't. This one is an annoying song for me because it's so symbolic of a movement of the time.
Hey, girl, what you doing?
This is from New Girl.
Hey, girl, I don't know this. No concept of this song.
New Girl ran from 2011 to 2018.
Who's that girl?
Is this another case of the star singing the theme song?
Oh, yeah, that's...
That's Zooey Deschanel.
That's Zooey Deschanel,
Zooey Deschanel.
Sure.
It's like...
She's charming, Zach. Leave
so
her alone.
Annoying. She's quirky. Sure. And I like she and him, the band that she sings in.
She's in 500 Days of Summer. You're not allowed to talk about it around
campus. And she's a brunette, and she's perfect.
She's not a brunette and elf.
Yeah. I don't like her an elf.
You hate blondes?
No.
I like Zooey Deschanel, but New Girl was the vehicle that took it all too far.
I totally disagree.
It took the shtick too far.
2.5 seasons were fantastic.
You're right. 2.5 seasons, and then everybody tired of it because it was all played out.
And then they actually changed the theme, made it worse, if you can believe it.
That's true.
I think it's a toe tapper.
I think it can be. Just listen
but
to
it's
literally
Zooey Deschanel's life
listen
story.
Listen to literally
Third
any
party
other she and him
objective listener here. I did not like that.
It's annoying.
Hey, girl.
And the way that they have
Leave Her Alone.
I thought it was like a 50s, like old.
That's Zooey Deschanel. She's from the 50s.
And like the multi-tracking, it's like she's not in time with herself on her multiple takes. And it's supposed to be cute, but
that's the joke.
Annoying. No.
Leave her alone.
That's the joke.
Leave her alone.
She's great.
She's protected.
Now bash on Third Rock in the Sun so he can defend Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
That is a great theme we should talk about more.
Save it for the next show.
I also am tired of don't cut your bangs. Just leave them. Leave them the way they are.
He's talking to you, Kent.
I love my bangs.
What?
Your what?
I love my bangs.
Oh. Oh, let's just...
It's getting hot in here, guys.
It is. Let's end this thing, huh? We are going to move into the best theme of the past decade. We actually had to force ourselves to talk about something a little more modern.
And this is the last category?
The last category.
Because themes, even though for sitcoms, like we talked about How I Met Your Mother, there are sitcoms, and CBS has a lot of these, where there are themes, maybe not as memorable, but you don't really see themes. It's just kind of an opening title.
Yeah.
Maybe a music beat.
Maybe.
And that's about recently. It.
Like even Supernatural, it's like that.
And that's it.
Well,
that was good, actually. Thank you, Predator.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like every time.
When you were picking yours, did you set the date? Like, did it have to start after 2010?
That's how I went.
I think the majority of it had to be in there. Like, there's some shows that bled into 2010, but I was like, no, it had to be like the bulk of it was over there.
Maybe. Yeah.
But I want to give a little backstory on this, is that Kent came up with this category, and he was like, I'm voting for that one. That needs to be in there. Let's put it in there. And I'm like, that's great. Okay. It's too bad we can't use Game of Thrones, though. And Kent's like, wait, what? And I said, we used it in the last show. He's like, you did? I didn't. I'm like, no, the rule is if anyone uses it on the show as their official pick, we cannot use it again if we do a sequel show.
That was my Lighted 7 pick.
And then Kent went, I hate you. Like, I honestly think
you should have seen my heart.
I think I offended you.
Ooh.
You're listening to Life and Death by Lost.
Yes.
But, and so I felt bad, Ken.
So we have to say this is the best theme of the past decade brought to you by the Game of Thrones theme.
Yes. So you,
other than the Game of Thrones theme, best theme of the past decade.
So please tell me you didn't pick that.
No, of course not, because we used it. I couldn't. I chose one that I feel was maybe a little more epic than Game of Thrones.
Ha 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 ha!
I love this song. I really do. I'm not saying it's better than Game of Thrones, yeah. But I'll tell you what, it is one of the best theme songs of the past decade. That is Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Oh.
Now, I know you two are both kind of, you know, old sourpusses and don't really like fun things, but...
Sounded like a cheap Wonder Woman song.
Well, it's just supposed to sound like all the cop shows from the
80s. That's what it is. Yeah. He took all the 70s horns from that, and then he turned it into the kind of this... I love the guitar riff that comes in there and makes it a little more modern. Brooklyn Nine-Nine, 2013 to present.
Yeah.
And it follows the exploits of the hilarious Detective Jake Peralta and his diverse, lovable colleagues as they police the NYPD's 99th precinct.
And it fits the show.
Oh, totally.
Yeah, it does.
It does.
And it is. Like, this is one where it's a fun theme. It's very short. Obviously, I played the entire thing just then. I never skip over it. The credits are really, like, the way they do the credits is just a lot of fun to watch visually. And it's just fun. It's silly. You listen to this, you're getting pumped up, and you're having fun at the same time. This is almost my pump up one.
Okay.
Because it is just kind of.
But it's just too short.
Da-da-da-da. Here's the weird thing, by the way. So, this was composed by Dan Morocco. I don't know if I'm saying his name right. But the show. September 2013 when Brooklyn Nine-Nine started.
Mm-hmm.
However, in a March of 2013 episode of Community, there's a part where Britta turns on a boombox and the horns from this song play. So it's one of those internet conspiracy things of like, why is the Brooklyn Nine-Nine theme song in Community? So listen for that. Season 4, episode 5.
Was it sampled from an older song maybe?
I don't know. That's what I wondered. But it's just funny because like they talk about how this, like you said, they took the horns, the classic kind of like 70s cop sound.
Got the vibe.
Yep. Got a little more modernized, a little more jazzy, a little more hip hop kind of sound to it. But it is. It's just fun. I would listen to this one over and over again. They'll have that 10-hour versions on YouTube and stuff like that.
Oh, man. Yeah.
I might make it a half hour into that of just this song over and over again. But yeah, both you haters looking at me right now, there's people out there who enjoyed that pick.
It's only haters because I'm ignorant of it. I just don't know the show.
You should watch it. You generally should watch the show.
I don't have time to watch TV shows all day.
You can watch this. You can watch this one while editing. It's perfectly fine.
And miss the jokes? I would never.
Comedies are harder to watch, I guess. But that's fun. It's a fun show. And it's a great theme. But yeah, Game of Thrones I probably would have picked, but we already picked it.
Mm-hmm.
I picked one that I'm guessing neither one of you would like. And it's actually not super family friendly. So, anyway. Do either one of you know this?
I like that you said that with hesitation, though, too.
Oh, yeah.
It's Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt.
Wait, editing it?
And I edited it.
Aww. What was that little skip there?
A little family friendliness there.
I family friendlyized it. Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt. I think it's a really fun theme. I always sing along, even the bad words.
Well, and I've seen the first couple episodes of this, and the whole thing comes out of one of those Songify the News types things, and they turn it into the theme song, which I thought was clever.
Yeah, it's fun. It's honestly one of the only memorable theme songs that you can actually sing along to that's come out in a show in the last decade. So that's my pick.
Worth watching? Because it feels like Tina Fey comedy with the quirkiness of Ellie Kemper.
It's worth having on in the background.
You just described the show.
Like, yeah, factually. So
it is.
That makes it me not want to watch it.
Yeah, you know exactly what it is. You probably wouldn't love it, but it's okay to have on in the background. It's definitely a I'm going to clean up the house type of show.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
But I like the theme. It's fun.
Well, I'm glad I'm ending, so we don't end on that one.
I planned it that way.
I'm going to end with a big epic piece. And yes, I couldn't use Game of Thrones, so I'm using the next best thing. The theme from Westworld, composed by Raymond Djawadi, who also did the Game of Thrones theme. This guy is amazing.
I don't know this.
I like it, though. Yeah, so listen to this. Like, you got to listen to it. There's a 5-minute version, but this one that plays the intro is a minute and 41 seconds, and it plays, it's like Game of Thrones. Mm-hmm. It plays the entire almost 2-minute song, and you never want to skip it because it changes every season. But I love this one because it opens and it looks like a valley in the Old West, and the camera kind of shows a new light on it. And what it shows is these android fibers are being created by this machine. And what they're doing is creating people. They're creating horses to be these android hosts. Do you know much about the Westworld show?
Well, that's because I've seen the movie, and until they came up with the show, I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah, so Jonathan Nolan, I mean, it's a name I kind of like. He created this show, which
Jonathan?
Is different. Yeah, Jonathan is different than the movie because, well, it's a way more in-depth Don't watch seasons two or three. Let's just do season one because it's an amazing show for one season.
Okay.
And there's so many twists and it's so good. This song did hit number 190 on US Billboard 200, which is surprising because it's just epic instrumental. Mm-hmm. But it is a great song. And this guy's great. What he does in this series is he'll take popular songs like Paint It Black or Heart-Shaped Box. Mm-hmm. And he'll do like hardcore piano versions. And they fit scenes like gunfights. Huh. In the streets, and it works perfectly. So the whole soundtrack's great. Yeah, take a listen, even if you've never seen the show.
Okay.
So yeah, that's my choice.
That is
for best theme of the last.
That is
decade.
A much better note to end on. Thank you for that, Kent.
You're welcome.
I was really scared.
Yours was good. I just want to make.
I was
fun.
Like counting around, going, no, I "Please."
Think a lot of people like the Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt theme as well. But so thank you, all you guys, for letting me learn about new songs and enjoy old favorites as well. Listener, let us know your picks for the various categories that we did. We want to hear your picks on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. When we post the show, let us know some of your favorite theme songs, and let us know which ones we still haven't talked about, even though we've done two TV theme song episodes. I can think of some major ones right now that I'm still surprised we have not brought up.
Yeah.
So let us know what we missed.
All right, but before we go, we'd like to thank our patrons. So first from the I and the Listener category, it's Terry Finley, Adrian Gray, who thank you for part one and inspiring the show as well.
Yeah.
Chris Drought, Braden Winterton, Jennifer Kilkowski, Sean Sanquist, Kyler Just Wants Joel's Approval, Alicia Bass, Crew Dutler, and Scott Sprague. And from the Bacon Council, we have Nicole D. Hale, Chris Anderson, Ryan Farron, Stephen Ross, Mats Mudro, Jessica Terry, Brian Madsen, and the Reverse Listener. Thank you all so much. We truly appreciate it. And even if we haven't read your name here, we thank you for listening every single week.
Thank you. Thank you. Sincerely. But if you want to find me, you can find me at 76Joel on Twitter. You can find me performing with Quickwits. They're performing for free online right now on Facebook. For more details, go to qwcomedy.com or go to the Quickwits Facebook page.
If you want to find me on Twitter or Instagram, you can find me at Kenny3DD. If you want to read my upcoming movie reviews, because movies are starting to come out, it's ShowtimeShowdown.com.
And if you want to connect with me, you can do so on Twitter and Instagram at TumblingMustard. But most importantly, make sure you are following Bacon Sale, like the page on Facebook, follow on Instagram and Twitter as well, and don't be afraid to comment on the Instagram post. It's okay. You can do that. While you're doing that, go to tpublic.com/baconsale and get yourself a t-shirt or a mask or some wall art, a magnet.
Those are all things.
All things you can get. And if you like what's going on with the show, you can show your support by going to patreon.com/baconsale, and you can support the show in some fun ways, get some extra bonuses. That starts at just $3 a month.
Mm-hmm. And for $3 a month, you can hear things like the adventures in Zack's new car that we just talked about.
Joel folding in half to do that. yes, we do picking bits sometimes.
So until next time, we won't know what to do with that tossed salad and scrambled eggs. They're calling again.
Scrambled eggs all over my face.
Good night, Seattle!
Moving on up to a deluxe apartment in the sky.
I need to get a drink.
Get a drink.
Moving
my
on up.
My throat is dry.
Come and knock at our door.
Say, I'm waiting for you.
I'll be waiting for you.
I have the full list from last time.
Let's do this, Poirot.
I am Detective Poirot.
Who's faster, faster than me? You'll never touch me.
Wow. Is that on Fortnite?
Doing it our way.
Bus flies by.
Don't you doubt me. Don't you doubt my knowledge of Star Trek Enterprise.
You stop it right now.
Never did it.
They kidnapped us and took us to Denny's.
You wouldn't sing along because you didn't know the show.
I know the show. How dare you?
Yeah.
Question my love for Punky. Mm.
It is not fit to be scraped off the bottom of a Klingon's boot.
Oh.
Yeah.
Burn.
Yeah.
Believe it or not, it's Daddy. Like stuff like that.
Fun.
Oh, I just teared up. That's so cute. Zack, once again, I'm giving you no faith.
Zack's got his overwhelmed eyes on.
You feel like you want to be a drug kingpin?
Oh, yeah.
Is that why you're laying the unitards today?
Yeah, it's a unitard. But we all have jazz hands universally.
Fame!
The great uniter.
Jazz hands. The great uniter of people.
Don't take that away from him.
Sorry, I get confused on the timeline of our marriages.
You're not going to win me over with Divine Comedy, Joel. I think it is fine. There are parts that are enjoyable.
Scrambled eggs all over my face. What's a boy to do?
He's a messy eater.
Bruce Miller, you're wrong and you're a liar. It is Baconsale approved, which is gospel. Gangsta Grass featuring Kent. It's like white girl gospel. You're already gaining estrogen.
Gilmore Girl fans will kill me for saying it's not a good song.
WKRP in Cincinnati.
The synopsis is The Misadventures of a Staff.
From Gandalf the Wizard.
Drink break. Drink break. I was first tenor.
I knew it.
And Danny Bonaducci was there.
And come on, Kent. Get happy.
Never. Did over you not salute again. The purple dinosaur?
Is that a drug euphemism? And when he's tall, he's what we call a dinosaur sensation.
He's a dinosaur sensation, Joel.
How is he a dinosaur sensation?
Zack, why don't you watch Barney?
Because he's an alcoholic.
I got real pumped up by Peppa Pig.
I family-friendly-ized it.
What is wrong with me? Am I an android?
We won't know what to do with the dust.
What is with this tonight?
Almost there. We're almost done.
The fray!